This emergency meeting of the Lee County Board of Commissioners will now come to order, and our invocation will be delivered by Mr. Hoyle.
Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank Thee for this day, the health and strength that enables us to come and meet. We ask You to look with favor upon the people in our county who have suffered loss, both personally and in their property. Be with them and comfort them in their distress and give them a quick release from their many problems. We ask our Father that You would be with the members of our armed services, particularly those serving in positions of peril. Allow them to discharge their duties with honor and hasten the day when they can return to this country. We ask our Father that You would bless the members of the Board of Commissioners, be with them as they go through the difficult problems brought on by the damage that was done to our community, as well as the need to establish a budget in these which are perilous financial times. All these things we ask You, gracious Father, in Your holy name. Amen.
Please remain standing for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Crumpton, you are the old business today.
I think I'm the only business besides some other things are going on. I see some representatives from the Red Cross today. I think we need to thank them for the hard work that they've done over the last week. And it has been quite a task that they've undertaken, and we appreciate their work. I'm going to go ahead and have Shane come up. He's got a PowerPoint to show you all that will bring you up to date on the latest of what's going on with the storm and some final numbers.
Good afternoon. We put this PowerPoint together. Don Kibotsky's helped us this afternoon. We were very fortunate that the company that does our flyovers was in Lee County on Monday and actually provided us with some high definition aerial photos of basically the storm track. One of the things, if you look on the map, you see the red line, then you see the dark red portions of it. Those dark red portions is where we had significant damage. So it's kind of like the storm was kind of skipping across the county. It stayed on the ground all the way across, but those are significant damage areas. The path is 13 miles plus now. Don and his group have been analyzing the photographs, and they're, you know, not only going by structural damage, but the number of trees and stuff down. I'm going to kind of flip through this, and you'll see how they had it laid out. But our first point of contact for the storm was at Rocky Fork Church Road. And then, I hope you can see this, but this is a before shot. This is a shot that was captured in 2010 in the winter. So you'll notice there'll be a difference in color on the map and also in different lighting. But that was before, and then this is after. So this was Monday. And you see there's a house that had significant damage with part of the roof taken off, and also that the white line you see behind the house, that's actually a transfer truck that was flipped over in the yard. So if you go back, you can see the damage. And I'll make sure that Mr. Crumpton has a copy of this so that you can actually have the photos for your computers. It's easier to see on a computer. Our next point of impact was at Joe Matthews Road, which runs off Willett Road and comes back around to Greenwood. And there again, you see the before pictures. And then after, and it doesn't pick the color up good on here. Porter's not coming. If you see in the lower left corner, that's a residence that's on Willett Road, and the storm kind of goes across at a 45 degree angle and it affects those properties on the kind of toward the top there. It was one house completely destroyed and two other houses that were hit pretty hard. Then we move it up. The next point of contact was over at Smith Road. You can see there was a chicken house and a barn. And then the barn's gone. It also took part of the roof off there. And we move up to Castleberry Road. And I know everyone's been familiar with the with the farm on Castleberry Road. So there you can see the bulk barns in place. Also look at the big trees there, just off the pond there adjacent to the bulk barns. And then that's the picture Monday morning of it. Mr. Thomas lost 32 bulk barns, shelters, all of his tractors, and those trees are gone. In those trees is a house sitting on a brick foundation. The house is also gone completely. The only thing that's left is the front steps and the rear deck. We move on to St. Andrew's Church Road. I'm sure everybody's familiar with what's happened there. There's the before picture from last year, and there's the picture now. Like I said, these pictures are hard to see on here, but on a computer, you can really see the path of the storm as it went across. Moved on up to Cemetery Road. There's over Cherokee Trail, J. Glenn Edwards School, Cemetery Road, and then you can see just the damage. I mean, you come across there and it completely destroyed those houses in that area, and then kind of caught the corner of our schools and went across. Industrial Drive, and there's the static control building, the old Eaton building, and that's what's left of the static control facility. So not only did you have some residential properties affected, but this is where it got into the commercial area. That's the neighborhood, kind of back in behind Tractor Supply and Big Lots. And you see, it's hard to see on the map, but I mean, it's completely destroyed those structures across there. And then you can see the top of the Tractor Supply building and Big Lots. It peeled the roof off of it. Then there's that parking lot, and there's the after, where it peeled the roof back. And you also got the Hardee's there, took the windows out of that building. Moved across to Lowe's, and which you have a digital copy of that in front of you. And you can see where it just come through the building. Then kind of skip across to Broadway Road there at Shallowwell Church. There's the intersection, and that's what's left of the houses there. Trees down in the parsonage. It destroyed these two houses at the corner of the bypass, Broadway Road, and then it skipped across, and when it came back down Rice Road, we had the same effect over there. I mean, it completely destroyed those properties. Then you can see this real track really, really clear, like I said, on your computer. It's hard to see in here with the light. And you also see the nursery back in there. It just completely devastated the nursery there, Watson's Nursery. Walnut Lake Circle. This is one of the ones that shows up real good in color. We come across these trees there and destroyed that, and you can see the barn there at the top of that field. It's gone completely. And then we're going to move right along to the horse farm. That's gotten a lot of attention, and this is a very good reason why. If you look at there, that's last December, and that's now. There's nothing there. The horse arena is gone, and the barns, that's gone. And now just for a short, quick once-over, FEMA has a community relations team out. They're going door-to-door. They're handing the pamphlets out. They're talking to the victims. And one of the things that they've been doing is just letting them talk. And that's real important, right, because that's part of the healing process. But if you look at that list, number of structures visited. This was their first day, so this was on the 23rd. They hit 148, I believe, structures where they went to the structure. They were able to contact face-to-face with just a little over 100 people, and I can get these numbers for you because it's kind of hard to see them there. They had structural damage reported in 91 of those structures that they visited. And then if you look over there in the bottom right corner, that's the number of occupants that are registered with FEMA. This time is a very low number. It was like, I think, 7 on the first day. So that's a low number. You know, they're spreading that word. Sheriff's Department's been spreading. We all have. But this is very important to get those people to go and register with FEMA. You know, whether they've got insurance or not, they need to go register. We'll go up the next day, which was Sunday. The community relations group, they were not going to work at all on Sunday, but you see they were out there. They actually visited 14 sites, made contact with 19 property owners. They had 7 that reported damage. And there again, we didn't have, but I think it was 1 person registered with FEMA on Sunday. So these are very, very low numbers. If you go over totals a day, they're close to 160 places that have been visited. Just a little over 100 contacted. We've got about 96, I believe, that's had some type of damage to their structure. And we're at about 11 there that has actually registered with FEMA.
Question for you, Shane.
Yes, sir.
When you say 11 registered, you're talking about folks that registered either over the phone or face-to-face over at the FEMA site?
Yes, sir.
So are they not registering when they go door to door?
They are out there to spread the word to get them to go to the DRC, which is the McSwain Center.
Or to call.
Or to call. They can either call, they can go online to disasterassistance.gov, or they can go do a face-to-face.
All right. Is it conceivable that some of these people may have transportation issues and don't have a phone?
Everyone we've talked to, if they don't have transportation, the FEMA guys are telling them we'll get someone out there to pick them up. We'll use Colts.
Yeah, I was going to say Colt should, I would think Colt would be a good way to get them out there.
Absolutely. Okay. And the point of contact was, you know, to get up with Sid Morgan there, and we would arrange for transportation to get them to the DRC.
We don't have any FEMA people here, do we?
Yes. And here? I don't think so.
What one of the problems that I found when I was going out around in the neighborhood up off of Rice Road and Thomas Road, there's some people still in shock out there.
Absolutely.
And they absolutely have no concept of what they're supposed to do.
Right.
I finally was able to talk one into it, and her daughter was there. She was going to go online and do it. The other one is still saying, well, go help somebody else. But their house, their trailer, they have a double-wide trailer, one of the older style. It's twisted.
Absolutely.
And at some point in time, they're going to have to fix it. And to convince them to go in and register, I haven't been able to do it yet, but I'm still working on it. But I'm finding that there are people like that. So if the FEMA people are really, you know, sitting there talking with the people, maybe that'll help a lot. But we do have some people that need that help.
We've been spreading that word as hard as we can spread it, you know, and the thing that a lot of people are telling us, we have insurance and we don't need to register. That's not the case. They need to register irregardless.
That's what I've been telling them. And so I think it behooves us still to get back out in the neighborhoods to try to convince some of those folks that they need to do it. We'll try to help do that.
We appreciate that.
We need to get that word out through the media. Can't we do that?
We've been hitting it hot.
I mean, it's been in the paper. It's been on the radio.
Most of them I've talked to have no radio. They don't watch TV, and they don't take newspaper.
Yeah. So I've been finding that, too.
The only way that you can get the information is go talk to them.
And make a face-to-face contact.
That's it.
The only other advocate group that we can go to would be the churches.
Yep. Yes.
There you go.
Ministers could probably apply a lot more logic.
Well, I'll give you an example this morning. One of the youth group called into the ESC had six teenagers that were in our youth group. They wanted to help. And we told them to come to the ESC. We got them a handful of those flyers, and we sent them out in Thomas Road area and told them to get door-to-door, start handing them out. And, you know, and the same thing with the Sheriff's Department. They've been doing the exact same thing. We've been getting them out. But, you know, I'm seeing the same thing. When you go out and talk to people, a lot of them are just in denial. We don't need to register with FEMA. The thing that people need to realize is that today they've got insurance, but 30 days, 60 days from now, there may be something there that there's a gap that was not covered by their insurance. Maybe a surprise, a hidden surprise. If they're registered with FEMA right now, that registration is there. They got something to fall back on.
Yeah, I would also add, I think you're right on a good discussion point here. I would venture the guess that there's not a single person whose insurance covers everything.
Absolutely.
And FEMA, though it won't necessarily fill in all the gaps that you have by getting on the registration, because you only got 60 days to do it anyway, getting on the registration is imperative, and then at least it opens a door for other resources.
Exactly.
Are they going to stay at the McSwain Center?
Yes, sir.
As long as they have traffic.
Okay.
And that's another issue that, you know, why it's important for the citizens to get over there and create some traffic is so that they know that they need to stay.
You know, Commissioner Reeves just mentioned another point. I think, you know, in addition to the churches, the Christian groups that are doing a lot of the volunteer work, and the men's groups that are out, like the United Methodist Men I saw this morning, Baptist Men been out there. We could arm them with a flyer as they go around to house and encourage them to hand those out as well. Because I know they're in the neighborhoods all over the county right now.
They have, I went around yesterday. I went to all the sites yesterday, which takes about 3.5-4 hours to get around to all of it. But, you know, Baptist Men, the Methodists, they were everywhere. We need to get some pamphlets to them. And we've handed a lot of pamphlets out from the EOC, but it's real important to get that out there. And that's that face-to-face contact that's going to make that work.
Right. Shane, is the window FEMA 50 days? Is that something?
We were told it was 60 days.
60 days.
Yes, sir.
Okay, and after that time, if someone should miss this opportunity for some reason, can they still contact FEMA, even if FEMA should move from the McSwain Center? Does it just shut down after 60 days, or can they, because of circumstances, still get to them and get their claim process?
And that is a question I cannot answer. I'll be glad to get with FEMA. Yeah, we'll get that message back to Mr. Crump and let him email it out to you, but we'll have to find that out. And I don't know if it would be a case by case or if it's just when they get to that point. I mean, I think from what we've heard, at the end of 60 days, if they still have traffic, they'll still be there. But they guaranteed us they would be here in Lee County for 60 days.
One thing we might want to ask too is that would they still have the ability to go online if for some reason we got? Because we had some people I know that's out of town, so.
So I guess we just need to find out, is that a hard number, 60 days? Is that a number that will be extended? Yeah. And what the actual closeout date will be? Okay, we can get that information.
Now, is FEMA sharing with us the addresses and the names for the people that register? I mean, I know it can be shared. I just don't know if they're doing that now.
They've not shared that number with them. Okay. They're just giving us numbers.
I would think that we could also do some prompting on our end, because I mean, I don't share if Carter's people are in every neighborhood. We could also perhaps get that exchange of data going on so that we know that at least every residential owner or occupant is being notified of, or has at least had the opportunity to be notified.
Okay.
I would think that we would want to capture that on a regular recurring basis from FEMA so that we can at least have that information available to us.
They actually have the assessment form that our assessors, when they went out and you know, to check the structure to determine what percentage of damage, they're going down that list, checking that list off. So, I mean, we can take that list and we should be able to see whether or not they've been in those areas.
Okay.
And they've been real good about communicating with us, scheduling a briefing every morning at 8 o'clock with us, getting us copies of the report. So the line of communications back and forth has been real good with them so far. Which, you know, we're 4 days into this, so as far as the recovery process.
We won't be meeting with them tomorrow. There's a major meeting up in Raleigh with the FEMA and the emergency management folks at 10, so Shane will be representing the county with that. But we'll get back into the FEMA meetings on Wednesday at 8 o'clock at the EOC.
One final point on the FEMA thing. One of the residents that had gone in on the phone to register with FEMA told me that he got confused. He spent about 50 minutes on the phone, got confused, and he got sent back and forth between the SBA and FEMA and was confused because he didn't realize, and that was news to me too, that SBA is actually in this business of helping residential owners and occupants, even renters, getting low interest loans. I was not aware of that.
Yes.
But apparently he was confused by it too, and they went back and forth for about an hour before he finally realized that they were trying to get him registered on both sides and capture all of his information to see if he was needing any loans from the Small Business Administration as well as the assistance from FEMA. So
yeah, that's one of the good things about going out to the McSwain Center.
Right.
One stop shop. You know, you'll get FEMA, SBA, also North Carolina Emergency Management. There's some things there that they can do to help. And also we have DSS. They have a person there from Lee County DSS to assist with, you know, food vouchers.
And the lady from the state as well, the state coordinator for unmet needs. I didn't even know she was out there. That's a really good thing to have because there are some people that may have needs or gaps aren't being filled elsewhere that she can take down and maybe help with.
Yes, sir.
That's a good thing, I think, for the press to also emphasize if they can in some way that it's a one-stop shop right there at McSwain so that all of these agencies are there. That really should be encouraged.
Yeah, you basically go in, check in with a guard there, register you, and you just work your way around the room.
Yeah.
So that's working out pretty good. But, you know, there again, we've got to get the people out there. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Shane, is that just for residential, or are they also processing commercial and agricultural business claims there?
The agricultural would be separate, but like when we went by there to check on the lunch, Steve Thomas was in there, which, you know, that was the big hit with the farm. Right. But he has some residential properties around there. He's also out there registering with them. So that needs to be the starting point. Get them in there and get registered and let them tell you what you're eligible for, what kind of help they can provide for you.
Okay.
And our USDA office is out there as well. So a farmer can go ahead and go into the USDA office in Cooperative Extension and go ahead and make contact there. So it really is one-stop shop for pretty much everybody. And that's one of the reasons why we put it out there.
We'll get through these slides right quick. the Disaster Recovery Center, which is at the McSwain Center, you see on there, that FEMA on the 22nd had 7 people come in. That was the afternoon when they set up, so that was Friday. Small Business Administration had 3. North Carolina Emergency Management had 4. DSS is on there, but they were not set up to start taking people today, so you see then that's a 0 on that side. The next day, we had 65 through FEMA. Small Business Association was 9, North Carolina Emergency Management was 11, and then there again, DSS started today. 24th, they had 18. Small Business Association had 7, North Carolina Emergency Management had 11, and then DSS. And then as of 2 o'clock today, they had 22 in through FEMA. Small Business Administration had 10, North Carolina EM 9, and DSS had 8 had come in. They said there'd been a steady stream of people coming in today, and that's good. Maybe the word's getting out there, maybe the passing the flyers out and spreading that word, starting a workforce.
What is NC Emergency Management? What are people doing?
They have certain programs that some people may be eligible for some aid, some of these grants to help them get back on the feet. There's a lot of different programs out there for people that are renters. There's programs out there for people that are homeowners. So basically, you go through the process, you tell them what you have, and they tell them what you're eligible for. And then the NCEM personnel also acts as a liaison back to these groups. That's kind of like they go between. I've talked to her a lot also. So it's just, you know, a great big one circle. I mean, you start there at the guard and you work your way around. Your last spot you'll get to is North Carolina Emergency Management. So the biggest thing they want to do is make sure that people don't miss something that they're eligible for. And that's what we need to push real hard.
Well, there's all the more reason to make sure that folks try and get registered in that 60-day period. The 60-day period may not be what you're expecting at the end of the 60th day. And the other consideration is if you have a second event and you're not registered for the first, you may have an even more difficult time. Let me ask, what are the hours that they commence at?
8 to 7.
8 to 7.
And that's 7 days a week. So if, you know, if they stay through, you know, weekend, they're here on, you know, 8 to 7 Monday, on Saturday and Sunday.
And then these are preliminary numbers. I know these are numbers that everybody's been waiting on. And, you know, keep in mind, these are preliminary. Matter of fact, when I was pulling up in the parking lot, I got a phone call and we had to make an adjustment on these numbers. In the opinion of GIS and the tax department, are actually kind of low. But these are preliminary numbers. But when we went through and did the assessment, one of the things the assessors, they grouped it into 4 groups. If it was totally destroyed, that's 100% of the tax value of the structure that's on the property. If it was major damage, it was 75% of the value of the property. And what the way we defined major was if the roof structure was missing, not just shingles, but the entire roof structure was missing. Minor damage was considered a wall missing. And I know, you know, that's not really minor damage, but we had to have a way to group it, and that was 25% of the value of the structure. And affected or isolated was 25% damage. That could have been anything from outbuilding to shingles blown off the roof to siding missing. When you see these numbers, the estimated value of the property was $57,078,718. The estimated damage was $47,256,275 in damage.
Now, Shane, are these numbers related to, when you say tax value, you're talking about on the books?
That number is actually populated and pulled straight from our tax records.
But they wouldn't include the contents, would they?
No, sir. This is actual structural damage, and that's it.
Right.
This building.
Now, for commercial buildings like Static Control and Kegel Furniture, those kinds of places, are there inventories in this number at all?
No, sir.
So any of the personal property would have been excluded from this number?
Yes, sir.
So that number could well approach $100 million then?
Absolutely. Right. Absolutely. But you see in there, estimated damage just to structures, $47 million. And then if you go back up to totally destroyed, it was $25,625,000. And these are just preliminary numbers, but that kind of gives you a ballpark figure of how big this storm was. You know, one of the things, Wake County got a lot of attention because they're very dense in their population and the number of buildings. But, you know, from what I've been told, and I'm sure John will reiterate this, the amount of damage we had here was a whole lot higher, yep, just because of the amount of destruction. You know, it wasn't shingles getting blown off or trees falling over. I mean, there's buildings completely gone. And that's it. And I'd be glad to answer any questions you might have.
Get those lights turned back on.
Yeah, I don't know what benefit it might offer or provide you, but especially in the area of farm equipment, when Floyd came through eastern North Carolina, there were a lot of farm tractors, trucks, and all that lost. And I don't know, or at least I don't remember, how FEMA involved themselves in that. But it may be good to take a look at, because a lot of people were made whole in some of those cases.
That'll go back through Susan Collins' group. It's still federal assistance, but they'll put a tax value on that, you know, or property value. Just that one farm, we've been told $3 to $4 million worth of damage. He had one tractor out of all the tractors he had that was not completely destroyed, and they had all the windows knocked out, so it had to be repaired where he could use it. You know, brand new combine there. I mean, we're talking major money just in equipment. And you think about bulk barns, you know, and that's just one place. You know, you've got Watson's nursery over there, which is completely devastated. So we'll get those numbers from the other side.
So all those automobiles that are damaged aren't included in here?
No, ma'am. That is that's walls, roofs, just the building. Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. Any other questions?
I'd just like to say again, Shane, we really appreciate all that you've done. I know it's been a hard road to go, but you've done a fantastic job. Same thing with Sheriff Carter's group there. I've had a chance to talk with several when I was going around the neighborhood and watch them talk to some of the people trying to come in. Always above, up and above board. Super bunch of people out there.
Thank you.
John too, and his group. So yeah. I'd just like to say thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for the support you provided to us. It has been a team effort, and no one has used the word no since this all started last Saturday.
I'm sure those training sessions that you go to pay off.
Yes, sir. We just didn't want to find out this way.
No.
Well, I can tell you that the one thing the training sessions can't help you with is the speed with which the decisions have to be made.
Yeah, yes.
Because you can simulate all you want, but until you actually have to get out there and make decisions and really move, it's a lot different pace.
Is there anything specific being done for renters? I know that sounds like a loaded question, but it's not intended.
They can do the same thing. They can go to FEMA and register with FEMA. And also FEMA has a team out working, trying to locate some properties, rental properties, trying to make sure that they've got enough places to put people that have been displaced. And that may even spread outside of Lee County. And, you know, we heard that dreaded word mentioned day before yesterday out there at the DRC, FEMA housing, you know, with the whole bringing in the campers and, you know.
I mean, formaldehyde.
Formaldehyde, yes. Mold, just the whole.
I mentioned that because ordinarily, homeowners are always the first that are thought of, but there are good renters.
Absolutely.
Also quite deserving, and we kind of get lost in the shuffle. So somewhere we ought to have at least a special significance stated for the renters to get in here and get rent.
Yeah, I believe that brochure that you handed me had that on there.
Yes, right, the programs.
I talked to some out on Popper Church Road that actually had moved their trailers on a rental property. Mm-hmm. And so some of them were going to go register. So,
well, I'll just go over a quick list. All these programs for FEMA, you know, are available to homeowners, renters, and small business owners. And the maximum award that someone can get, of course, there's a lot of different factors that goes into this, but it's $30,200. And those funds can be used for housing repair, temporary living assistance and housing, personal property replacement, transportation needs, medical, dental expenses, legal expenses, funeral expenses, disaster, unemployment. And then, you know, what the FEMA grants don't cover, SBA loans can be used for typically, you know, any gaps that might be there, or especially gaps in insurance for home replacement. So that's where SBA gets involved, is because FEMA is not in the loan business, and the awards are capped. So if you end up going above that cap, you'll get into a loan program.
John, question. Do are homeowners encouraged or enabled to go ahead and get started, or do they have to wait for a time until they get some type of official approval? In other words, is there sort of a, if after FEMA has, you've registered with them and up to these limits, would they likely say, go ahead and get your home under repair, get it started, and it's, you would know confidently that you're going to get reimbursed, or do you have to wait until you get a letter that says you are officially approved, yada, yada?
Well, they're given confirmation that they're approved. So I wouldn't do anything until I do get that confirmation. The big thing that would hold a person up on home repairs isn't FEMA. It's actually your insurance adjuster. So, you need to have a written statement from your insurance company before you start doing anything. We've seen some homes bulldozed and pushed to the road, and I sure hope they had everything cleared out with their homeowners insurance before they did that, because they just pushed their evidence to the road.
I would add that you don't have to have your insurance adjustment or even had eyes put on your property before you can get registered with FEMA, though. The protocol is register with FEMA as quickly as possible, because you don't know how long it's going to take some of these adjusters to get out to your property. I know there's some that are being told that they're not going to get seen until Wednesday of this week or later. So even with local agents here in town, they still haven't gotten there. And I know the school teachers, Horace Mann finally got their adjusters here for the school teachers, but some of the Allstate claims were being settled over the weekend are not going to get to though this week. They should go ahead and get the FEMA registration done now, and they can fill in the blanks later. As soon as the insurance gets done, that's when you can start taking a lot of the action to get things repaired and cleaned up.
We had any permit applications yet?
Yes, building inspection has had permit applications already. Not a lot, but they are starting to get them, and folks are starting to approach them about getting their permitting in order. Same with environmental health. A lot of questions about septic tank issues. We discussed that last Monday, and those are already being worked out. Okay, moving on. Just so the audience hears, the FEMA number is 1-800-621-3362, and their website is www.fema.gov. So people just hear that. As Shane said earlier, we are having the daily briefings with FEMA at 8 o'clock. We're skipping tomorrow, but we also have a daily conference call with the state emergency management folks. They talk about issues that are coming up across the state. They seem to be exceptionally concerned right now about homelessness and people being scared to tell you that they're homeless. And they're also concerned about making sure people are being fed and getting meals. So Shane alluded to that, they are having meals delivered to the McSwain Center just as an additional spot. So if you time it right, you can go to the McSwain Center for lunch, fill out your application, and get lunch. So, it might be something else for it. But they seem to be real concerned about that. So I'd encourage people, if they're having any of those issues, they need to go ahead and bring it to our attention or FEMA's attention. There are enough people out there right now that, no one should be falling through the gaps like that right now.
John, how many counties have supplied building permits people or other people that's come to help us?
We've had two different areas. We've had help from Pittsboro and Chatham County, and then we've had help from Aberdeen, Southern Pines, and Moore County.
Okay.
And Pinehurst, better not forget them. So there's about six jurisdictions and two counties.
Could we get an update on the damage to Jay Glenn Edwards and East Lee? Do we have any? I've seen the teams working out there. I know they're going at it. And I assume that even though the kids went back to school today, They're not, or tomorrow.
Tomorrow,
they won't be able to go back to school, it looks like, in at least one of those, or is that the plan?
No, they plan on taking them back to J. Glenn Edwards tomorrow. Classes will be confined to the classroom.
Right.
They won't be able to go to the gymnasium or the media center, since both those roofs are missing. And
same thing for East Lee?
East Lee, there's no damage to the classrooms. Most of their damage is outside.
It looked as if they were working on the HVAC system out there today. Have we had any reports on, because I know there were teams up on top of the roof working with the HVAC, or maybe they were just trying to batten down the hatches. I don't know.
That has not been communicated to us. We have talked to Dr. Moss. I talked to him twice this morning about issues. He did not indicate they were going to have any problems starting school tomorrow. Their deductible on both buildings is $2,500. So they're hopeful that insurance will cover that all, and except for the $2,500. And I think they can probably cover that $2,500.
One other thing I caution folks about, I don't know if they're still doing it at this day and time, but in the past, some folks would start working without getting the authorization and sort of remodel or build something different and find themselves stuck
in trouble
for all the expense. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
They didn't get that clearance first.
I think, have there been any instances of unlicensed contractors coming in from out of state or other places? So what does the public need to know there? I know Saturday out at the EOC, we saw somebody come in, wanted to get registered. He was from Pennsylvania.
Absolutely. Yeah, just make sure that you're dealing with a reputable contractor. Check the references on them. Between us and the Sheriff's Department, we've been trying to filter that. We had a lot come in Saturday. They would come in. Some of them identified themselves as FEMA subcontractors. And then, you know, all you had to do was ask them, let me see your ID. Well, I'm picking it up tomorrow. And, okay, let's call FEMA. They're across the street, and they'll be here in a second. And then that's the end of that conversation. They're gone. I just need to be careful of that. We've had people call wanting to go out and pick scrap metal up.
What happens with those people that leave, though? How do you know they're not going into the neighborhood?
We got some good checkpoints.
We can let the sheriff address that.
Yeah.
Sheriff, you want to address that? It'll be part of your presentation anyway with security.
We the areas that were affected, we have security there that's monitoring that. So,
so the contractor, would they know which contractors were approved or not approved? Do they have some sort of ID that you're issuing them? Or?
They would get clearance from the...
I'm sorry.
That's fine. One of the things we've told them, if they come in there and they're a contractor, it's hard for us to tell if they're legitimate or not. If they say they're going to go do work, and we'll use St. Andrews as an example, we've been called to come do repairs in St. Andrews. The first thing we ask them, all right, where's the address that you're going to? And guess what? Every one of them told them, we don't know. You know, I just know where to go to. And then the next thing, who are you working for? Nobody can provide us a name. Okay, well, what's the phone number? Well, I don't know. They called us, but we're just supposed to go over there. If they don't meet that criteria, they don't go. We don't give them a pass. And if they don't have that blue pass, they're not going to let them in.
Okay, so that's the question I have. They do have a pass.
Yes.
Shane, do you have a number to the North Carolina License Board?
Yes.
That's one way.
You can stop that problem.
You can root them out.
We're not allowing people to go in these areas and go door to door. We don't allow that in the county anyway.
Yeah.
And at some point, we're going to scale back our security and open up some of these roads. We're still going to have additional security out there for quite a while. And we just want folks, like Shane said, to go with a reputable company. Go with somebody you know. Go with local people that have references. But be very careful of any
contractor's license as well.
There's going to be so much to do. There's going to be a lot of people coming in. They know it's here.
Yeah.
But main thing is to make sure they have a license, they approve a North Carolina license board.
And the insurance.
If they are, then most of the time you've got a reputable contractor.
So even if they're from out of state,
they've been approved by North Carolina.
I would just like to commend the sheriff and his sentries out there all over the county. The checkpoints and the protocols they're following right now are very compassionate and yet still secure, and I think it's excellent what they're doing. They're open because you run into all kinds of permutations of people that need to get in there for different things. Pastors going to visit their clergy, the members of their congregations, volunteer organizations carrying food and water and meals to residents that are, some of which are still without power and inaccessible otherwise. And I know they've been very, very good about checking people, making sure that they've got a destination to go to, an address to go to, and if they don't, to be patient and make them go verify that before they let them in. I think that's great.
I'm going to switch gears real quick to animal control and discuss some issues. The sheriff gets to stand there and see how fast Shane left that podium. I have talked with Lee County Animal Services in our office up on 421. We're going to be open from 8 to 7 this week. The reason for the extended hours to 7 is if anybody needs any help with an animal or is concerned about a lost pet, we're encouraging them to contact the sheriff's office or the shelter and go by the shelter and give us that information about their lost pet. Also, we met with Kara today. We're trying to work jointly to match pets back up with their owners. And right now, Kara needs some cat foster families. They put the pets in people's homes for a temporary period for numerous reasons, but their number is 774-9433, and we encourage them to, folks to contact them if they can volunteer their services to help that organization. So we're going to try to set up a way for folks to send us their pet information if they've lost a pet. We're going to try to post it on our webpage and try to match up, and also put some, if they'll send us that information, we're going to try to put posters around town. We haven't had a lot of those type of issues, but we're hearing through the internet that there is. So people aren't contacting us directly, but we're seeing some stuff out on, and I don't Facebook, so I have to get Shane to Facebook it for me and send it to me, but that there are some issues out there. So please call us and let us know and let the sheriff know. His staff has done a good job of matching up pets, and we do have some local veterinarians who right now are doing some free veterinarian service if your pet was injured during the storm. So we can help you with your pet, and just we need to know that you need some help. Any other questions on those updates before I switch into storm debris discussion?
I have one other question, probably for you, Mr. Manager, on the area of insurance company adjustment. One of the two biggest complaints I seem to be hearing as we get around is the complaint that I haven't yet got my adjuster out here, and I'm not real sure when they're going to get here. Is there anything that the commissioners or that we can do as county government to help expedite getting eyes on the property and getting that block checked for these homeowners and these renters?
Well, the first thing I do is obviously the homeowner's over to contact the adjuster if they're having problems getting them out there. There's two places they can call, and I forgot to grab the Department of Insurance hotline number, but the governor's hotline number is 888-835-9966. That's really more of an informational line right now, but if you're having problems in that area, you can leave a complaint there as well, and ask the governor to get involved with the insurance commissioner and file that complaint. And the other thing is, as far as this board can do is just do the same thing. It's called the secretary or the commissioner of insurance and file a complaint, have them try to get them, have representatives come down here. They have fraudulent folks and customer service folks who can come down to this area and investigate some of these complaints directly. So we can contact them directly and see if we can get them down here.
John, I have a question. Perhaps this is more for Shane, but are there any lessons learned about early warning from this experience? I see the same weather forecasting you do, well, by and large, and see another strings headed across the country, and I just wondered if you're satisfied, and if there were good lessons to be learned in what happened. Just one experience that I had. I happened to subscribe to this service out of WRAL, and sure enough, I got a call at 3 o'clock last Saturday, and it was that call the first time. And I called a number of neighbors because this message said, take shelter right now, a tornado is in your area. And I called a lot of people who did not know about it, and otherwise they would have been sort of, without that kind of critical information. Now, you can't have that necessarily available to every person, but kind of set me to thinking and wondering about, we don't have horns that blow or things like that. So any word to the wise, any thought about early warning? Because we're going to probably have, hopefully never, but maybe more of this kind of tough weather.
I would say if I could give the best piece of advice would be to stay informed. Pay attention to weather. This is one of those storms that actually they said on Friday that we better watch for what's coming through. As far as early warning, this is one of those weird storms. I actually got a text from one of the forecasters at the National Weather Service at 1:30, quarter to 2, that said you need to keep a close eye on the radar. And, they knew that we were at the Broadway Arway Festival. I'd already been on the phone with him several times that morning. He's like, if y'all are not finished, you need to wrap up. We were wrapped up. They were closing that up. I'd actually made it out to Northview to the ballpark to see a ball game. Got the message, you need to start watching. I left. Abby Cameron from the Red Cross called me. She had lost power and asked if she could come to the office. Long story short, went to the office. Commissioner Womack's outside. When I get there, we talked about the weather for about a minute and a half.
Yeah.
Went inside and we started watching this. The weird thing about the storm, Lee County never got put into a severe thunderstorm warning. It was all the way around us on three sides, but not Lee County. Abby and I were sitting at a desk in my office, and I told Abby, I said, do you see that dot right there? I said, do you know what that is? And she said, yeah, that's a tornado. And it was about 10 miles south of Carthage, where it formed. And we sit there, and we were sending it out on Nixle, which is free. You can go online to nixle.com and sign up for it. Nixle will do two things. There's a human element involved, and there's not a human element involved. They'll send warnings out from Nixle also without us doing anything. This is one of those things that I'm sitting at a computer. National Weather Service implemented a new program called National Weather Service Chat. It's basically made for the media, for National Weather Service, and EM managers. We were monitoring it. Abby and I were sitting there at the computer. Deputy said they'd spotted a funnel cloud at Hollywood Road, which is in the southern part of the county. I sent a text message put straight on the National Weather Service chat. 15 seconds later, everything went off. Tornado warning. Now, whether or not we keyed that happening or they saw it on the radar also, it started. I sent three messages out, and the last message I sent out on Nixle was the tornado's on the ground in St. Andrews, please take cover, and pretty much we've been going at it since then. So that was some early warning. The system that you have, WRAL, that's great.
Can a person get this type of coverage that you have in your office, or do you have to have a special? I watch the networks, but I don't know that I have what would show tornadoes for me, or that most people would.
You can see a lot on WRL from what you would see on WRL at the Doppler, which I know you've probably seen it on the news since last Saturday. They show a hook. Mm-hmm. The hook signifies that tornado. What Abby and I were actually looking at was base velocity on the storm, and what it's looking for is air going in different directions. Mm-hmm. And when it picks a tornado up, if it's going away from the radar, it's green. If it's going towards the radar, it's red. And then when that red pops up, you have circulation there.
Yeah, pretty much, though, you have to be trained in weather radar because
for that,
otherwise
yes.
You won't understand what you're looking at. I watch weather radar on my computer, but I train weather radar.
But the biggest thing, stay informed. WRL's got it. Channel 11's got it. National Weather Service has it. You can get some advanced warning. Get you a good weather radio.
One of the cheapest ways is a little weather radio.
Absolutely.
And I had that going the whole time. And I was getting Lee County warnings.
Well, the other thing is online. You can actually, I know my wife found it online.
Your computer goes out, though.
30 minutes before it hit Lee County. She said that there was a tornado warning for Lee County. 30 minutes before it actually was seen in St. Andrews. Now, it may have hit a little earlier than that out further southwest, but yeah, I'd say either online or get a weather radar.
One of the things, though, that concerns me is they test sirens out in our area once a week.
For Harris.
Yeah, but why couldn't those be used for weather?
That's not a question I can answer.
That's the first thing that I did whenever I first heard it go off when I was out in my trailer. It scared me to death.
You said it's in Harris.
They have sirens out there that's part of the EPZ zone.
But, so I called in to see if, in fact, I called the sheriff's office to see do we have a thing. They said, no, this is just a test. That was my first week here. And so I don't know why we couldn't use that for weather.
Well, they're only in that 10-mile radius around the reactor, the Sheriff Harris. That's part of the REMP program.
Well, at least we could have it for out there.
Next thing, weather radio.
That little weather radio is just absolutely fantastic because it goes right to the National Weather Service.
But then the flip side of that, a lot of people get complacent because you have warnings coming out all the time, whether it's wind warnings, fire warnings. People get to the point that they start not paying attention. But now you can guarantee if they set a warning off tonight, everybody will be paying attention. And so complacency plays into that a lot.
Yeah.
The North Carolina Department of Insurance Consumer Service Division number is 1-800-546-5664. And another reason, and the sheriff just pointed that out to me, that some folks maybe not be going to the FEMA site is you have to have your homeowner's insurance policy with you. And so if you lost everything in your house and some things got blown away, you might not have your policy. So,
but you can still register and just fill in that blank later.
You can still register. So you need, folks still need to register. Want to explain a little bit about storm debris removal. Last week we approved the contract with Bird Brothers. Bird Brothers is currently working within the city limits. In the residential areas there, only doing debris removal. And in the unincorporated areas of the county, the secondary roads, the DOT is doing that pickup. Now, the county has a memorandum of agreement that was approved a year ago, which allows the county to step in and take the debris cleanup over in the secondary road system. We can take up all the roads, or we can just take up selective secondary routes. We met with DOT this morning. We talked to them about activating the MOA in some of the more densely populated areas. However, there's some concern about, if the DOT's already made one run through those areas, that now there's only one entity that can be reimbursed for those areas, and that would have to be them. The DOT is not picking up C&D right now, because the only site they have to take C&D is to the waste management transfer station at $43 a ton.
Please tell the public what C&D is.
Construction demolition debris, pretty much anything that came off of your house. So anything that came off the house, shingles, windows, 2x4s, brick, anything that's part of the house, sheetrock.
So they're being charged that by whom?
Waste Management runs the transfer station.
That's local here, or?
Yes, sir. That's transfer station up 421. The county closed its C&D landfill 2 years ago. We were losing money, and instead of keeping it open and losing money, we closed it. So we're trying to set up, I'm gonna let Joe come up here. Joe will come up and we'll talk about some of these things that are going on with this. But I will say this, the pickup in the city is going along real well. Hal Hagler's here and from the city, and that pickup's going well. And what we really need to talk about is, what we're going to do out in the county. So
I would like to, before you drive on to that, the city pickup is going well. Mm-hmm. Are they not using the same contract vehicle we're using?
Oh, yes.
Okay.
They're using the same contract.
At some point, I want someone to explain why is it the city's is going so well and ours isn't in terms of the pickup, the debris pickup, and are they also getting the C&D? Because it seemed like they were getting their C&D materials picked up and deposited somewhere for the city?
The DOT was not using the same mechanism that Burt Brothers is. You know, they have the dual huge boxes on their trucks. You know, first box is for leaf and limb pickup, right, and then the second is for the C&D pickup as they go along. DOT made a first run through and just picked up the vegetative leaf and limb debris that they thought was part of the right-of-way. And actually, they kind of hurt themselves by doing that based on an interpretation the state made to us today. You know, they should have been picking up everything as they went along. But now they, you know, looks like, you know, some of these roads, they may have to go back twice again. And then also the state, their site that they had approved was only for vegetative debris. We have a site off of Eakes Road where we take the debris and then we sort through it and then we take it to the final resting place. The state's site was only for the vegetative debris. So they, you know, they didn't want to pay the $43 a ton at transfer station. I think the thing you have to remember here is that the state picks up 25% of the bill for these things. And, you know, when they're picking up 25% of $43 a ton, they're taking on a pretty big expense. So another thing is Bird Brothers is being paid by the yard. So whether they work 80 hours a week or whether they work 40 hours a week, they're getting paid the same amount by us. DOT, you know, they're trying to limit their overtime and that kind of stuff. So
John is paying 75%. If the DOT is paying
25%. FEMA. And I think that's one of the things we ought, you know, I forgot to bring this up, but I think we need to realize that not everything's FEMA reimbursable. Not every expense that the sheriff has incurred in security will be reimbursable. Not every expense that we've incurred in animal control or emergency management or public works. And, you know, so there is going to be an expense to the county in this deal. So, and it's one of the lost reasons of why we carry a fund balance. FEMA is a reimbursable expense, and that's another reason why, you know, there are some, when DOT wants to step in and take on the big project, which is debris removal, you let them do it because they're playing with their money. Whereas when we take over it, you know, it becomes reimbursable from them and we have to front the money.
So if that was the agreement, what's the problem with DOT? I mean, they don't want to do it, but if they made the agreement, why aren't they doing it?
Resources, I guess I would say, you know, the resources to do it. The contractor commits as much as it takes to get in there and get out because time is money for them. And with DOT, the more time it takes, you know, for them.
So does the governor need to tell them to get on the ball and get it done?
I think she's done that, but I think there's still going to be some of that.
Well, I'm sure we're competing with other counties for those resources right now as well.
Well, according to our local DOT today, they said that we were one of the few counties that didn't activate the MOA right off the bat, which I found surprising because there were several of the counties that we heard on the conference calls who were asking questions about when DOT was going to start, when they were going to get going, what are they picking up. And it's normally a smaller county like us. Or even smaller. You know, there's several counties around us, Harnett, and then off in the northeast, Bertie, that have fund balance issues right now. So they don't have the money to front. So they're gonna hang with the DOT as long as they can.
So in your meeting in Raleigh tomorrow, will that be one of the issues that comes up? Or?
I'm not sure, but it's tomorrow is really to claim we're gonna designate Shane is our representative tomorrow to sign any and all paperwork that's necessary for us to be claiming reimbursement from FEMA. And that's really what that meeting is about.
I would hope that you could get a daily update from DOT about their level of activity. I assume they're still working here.
Oh, yes, sir.
Okay, and we could get a daily update about the number of trucks, the number of resources they got working and their plan. Certainly they're not just flying by the seat of their pants. I mean, they got to have a plan.
Well, I think they have some sort of a plan. What we wanted to do is take some of the more densified areas and give it to Bird Brothers. We ran that plan by the state today, and I wasn't at the meeting with Joe at one today. I was at the other meeting. And you know, they said, well, if they've already been down some of these roads picking up the vegetated debris, you know, that's now their road. You know, they're the only ones that can get reimbursed off of that road, which we didn't think was necessarily correct, but, you know, if that's what the state was interpreting. Well, they want to keep doing it, we'll let them do it. We were getting ready to take them off their hands.
And that person from the state wasn't the DOT director. It was
the assistant director for FEMA in charge, emergency management in charge of debris. Isn't that what his title is?
I believe so.
Right. Yeah. So I guess what we need to do is find out who that guy works for. Is that what we need to do?
Yes. I met him the other day too.
So what do we need to really do, John? Is there anything that the board needs to do as far as moving this process along?
What I'd like for you to do is give me the authority to meet with DOT and work out those roads that we can hire Bird, or that we can put Bird contracting out there on, and so that we can start moving a lot faster in this debris pickup.
John,
and that's really all I'm looking for today, because I need to get with, first of all, I need to get with Bird Brothers, then I need to get with DOT. I need to find out which roads we can take over and make sure that we're going to get reimbursement, and when that happens, so that things will start moving along faster. You know, otherwise DOT could be out there for the rest of the year.
The way DOT operates, if they're overwhelmed, they subcontract, they contract it out to contractors,
right,
who have the equipment and the size trucks they need to haul and stuff.
And they were wanting to actually do some work with Bird Brothers now. So, you know, it's at a point where we just need to clarify it, what areas we can put Bird Brothers in and let them go ahead and do it. And it will move along a lot faster.
I know Joe's going to give us a presentation of some sort.
He's up there to answer questions,
okay.
Really.
Well, maybe either you or Bird Brothers, main man here, can answer this question. I live just north of the Quality or the Best Value Inn on 421, where two of his subcontractors are sitting since Thursday, waiting, chomping at the bit to go to work. And I can't imagine that that's not costing money to somebody. These two big trucks came out of Michigan, and they've been waiting to go to work, and they're very frustrated. I you know, that's frustrating to me, to be looking at piles of debris everywhere and having the trucks and the teams ready to go, and yet you know, something holding it up. That just
I can't speak to those specific trucks, but I can tell you that we've had three trucks out there
right
Friday and Saturday
and today and still sitting there.
Some of them, well, I'll ask Carl to come up and give you the specifics on those crews.
For us, it's not operationally efficient to put that many trucks, and then becomes a safety issue to put that all in the city area. We brought those trucks to kind of hold them back as a just-in-case scenario for you guys. As always, we must plan on those contingencies. And if you guys do enact that, those trucks are ready to go, and you know, we're just kind of waiting for whether the DOT were to shake loose or simply you guys were to enact the MOA.
Are all the areas being covered, though?
Currently, right now.
Is the area up north up here on Thomas Roads, and they're being covered?
They ran down Rice Road.
Did they?
Which means that, you know, they're kind of picking their spots as to where they're going. They're kind of, I would say, bouncing around. And
why are they bouncing around? I mean, it seemed to me like it would be a nice, clean sweep through.
There you go. Yeah.
Well, ultimately, it falls upon whose responsibility the roadway is. And the county doesn't maintain any roadways, you know, in the unincorporated areas. The only road system that is really maintained by either the city or the county are the inside city jurisdiction.
So this is what you need from us, is to have a motion to put you in charge of that. Is that what you say?
Yes, sir. And that to activate that part of the MOA that we can put Bird Brothers on as soon as possible.
I make that motion.
John, is this being handled out of the division at Aberdeen?
Yes, sir. And I'm talking with Chuck and Tim.
With who? Tim.
Yes, sir.
How about our DOT board member?
I have not spoken with Mr. Burns.
Mr. Burns needs to contact you. Yes.
But that's, if we make a motion where John takes charge of it and whatever it takes to get this done.
Give him the authority to
that's
go
right
ahead and expedite the processing of this.
Well, in addition to that, I'd like to see the board send a letter to Mr. Burns.
There you go.
We can do that.
Quickest way to get it done.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Motion has been made. Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say nay. Motion passes.
So let me clarify one thing you were saying, Carl. It's Carl, right?
Yes.
Okay. The trucks that you have here, you have some backups in case you have have some areas that free up, and the ones you already have working are already fully committed. But yet we also have a number of areas that have had debris that's been cut since last Sunday for a week that's sitting and piled up and still not, it's in the unincorporated areas, it's still waiting to be picked up. So how many total vehicles do you have at work right now, and how long do you estimate before you'll have all of the accumulated debris, I'm talking about the natural debris, picked up and deposited?
Right now we do have three trucks working. Each one is a self-loader carrying a pup trailer. They're averaging anywhere from between 120 cubic yards to 140 cubic yard capacity. Right now we're averaging roughly 30 loads a day. I think the first day with rain, I think we had about 1,400 cubic yards. The next day we had about 2,100 cubic yards. Based on those estimates and what we've seen out in the county, we're estimating total there's going to be about anywhere between 30 and 40,000 cubic yards. I've already run some estimates, and in a 15-day period, with already 2 days or 3 days gone now, we can have that cleaned up with 10 trucks. Obviously we'll strive to beat that goal, and we'll look to put on 6 trucks, specifically designating one, maybe two for St. Andrews, and then another one solely for Rice Road. We do maintain a secondary debris management site that we're currently trying to permit at Rice Road, actually at the Watson Nursery. He's been kind enough to provide us with a piece of property there that we can utilize if need be, but that was specifically as a secondary measure for the NCDOT to haul in C&D. We're currently awaiting approval from Diener, and hopefully if we were to receive that, then we'll have that opportunity to enact that site and clean up the debris even quicker because it reduces our haul time.
Yeah. The main concern I had about St. Andrews is the fact that we got debris. It's a fairly narrow road network through there.
Yes, sir.
And it's already dicey, and there's really a security and safety problem in there now. With the way the debris's been piled up, there's so much of it that it's encroaching on the road. It's really become one-lane traffic up and down that road network. And it's incumbent before these residents can actually get out there and start doing some other things to clean up, to get that debris out of there. A lot of these are small front yards. And it's just to see it cut up. The Baptist men had it cut up, on Monday or Tuesday of this week, and here we are a week later, and the stuff's still piled up. And nothing's been moved. And I think it's frustrating for residents. It's frustrating for those of us in government trying to figure out, what do we got to do to get that going.
So, John, the reason Bird Brothers hasn't been out in St. Andrews is because there's part of the MOA that hasn't been activated yet.
That's right.
That's what we just authorized you to do.
That's right. But we have to make sure that since DOT's gone through St. Andrews that...
There's no evidence of that, by the way.
I'm not going to disagree. that FEMA is not going to have a problem with us billing that.
Okay.
Duplication.
If you don't mind me to add, the reimbursement mechanism for DOT is normally the Emergency Relief Program under FHWA. Raleigh has not submitted their formal letter to receive that reimbursement yet from that agency. Therefore, everything is now falling under FEMA to go ahead and pick up the tab, really. So whether, it's just, DOT going down there or the county going down there, I am confident that we can get that reimbursement for you guys. We do have a FEMA specialist on staff that's used to be a public assistance officer that is here to guide not only, Mr. Cherry and Mr. Spivey and Mr. Crumpton through the entire process, but just to assure that we're going to get that reimbursement and you guys aren't stuck with anything, because that's one of the most important things, that your budget stays, ready for you guys to use in the future.
How long is it going to take us to get that done?
To get what done, sir?
To get the approval.
To get the approval from DOT?
From FEMA. We're going to
That's
working on that in the morning.
So do we need to issue a letter as a board to DOT telling them to explain to us and get on the ball to get this done?
I'm going to write a letter to Mr. Burns telling him that, obviously this is more than what they can handle, and that we're ready to activate the MOA, but we got to make sure that we're going to get reimbursement.
Right. Okay. We'll leave that in your hands.
Yes, sir.
I would just ask or suggest that if you're going to make a decision that's going to encumber the county to a, and I know you already know this, but I just want to remind you that if it's going to impact our current year or next year's budget in any significant way, over about $10,000 or $20,000, that you would at least do us the courtesy of letting us know that, right?
I'm letting you know right now that we're impacting our budget over $20,000.
Okay. And we just empowered you to do some activity, but that doesn't mean it's a blank check, right?
Oh, don't worry about it. I understand. I got the finance officer over there trying to keep me straight in this.
So, good.
She's active in it.
I wanted to ask a question.
Yes, sir.
With all the debris and all the limbs and stuff, are you going to have a problem finding a place to dump all this stuff?
We've already located a place to recycle all the wood chips. Anything that might be generated, we want you guys to have that recycling benefit. Now, as for the C&D that is brought in, we'll try to sort and separate that as much as possible. Lee Iron and Metal here in town, we'll try to look to utilize them as much as possible. But ultimately, there will be some of the debris that we'll just have to go to the transfer station and landfill at that point.
This may not be for you, but maybe for Joe. The there was one, I think I saw it in the Herald, there was one free landfill for natural debris, I think it was, on Pickard Road, is that correct?
That's a stump dump, yeah.
That's a stump dump. It's privately owned by Johnny Knight.
It's not free.
They do charge you by the load.
They charge you by the load.
I saw it advertised one place as a free place to take it, but I guess.
Well, I can't say he's not gotten away with the tipping fees, but my understanding is it is charged.
So far as you know, there's not a free place that if some residents had some minor limb damage or whatever and they wanted to haul it on off to take it somewhere, there's not a free place they can take it to your knowledge?
Not at this time.
Okay.
All right. Thanks, guys. Madam Chair, the last item is the sheriff had to leave, but he asked me to get the board to extend the state of emergency and curfew till 8 o'clock Friday morning. At that point, he would like to lift the state of emergency and the curfew and open the roads up. He has a plan to continue to patrol the areas. He's going to have people in those areas, but he's going to take down the road barricades and that kind of stuff. So we just need a motion to extend the state of emergency and curfew till Friday at 8.
Current one ends at 5 o'clock today?
Yes, ma'am.
It ended 10 minutes ago.
So.
Okay, so motion has been made. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay.
That's till this Friday.
At 8 o'clock in the morning.
I know that's the last of the agenda items. I see that our chamber president is here, and I would like to see if he'd be willing to come forward and talk about anything that the chamber might be doing. If it's up to him, if he wants to talk.
There's a microphone there. He likes to use it.
anything, Bob, that you know of that the chamber's doing to reach out to businesses that you want to make public here?
Thank you, Commissioner Warmington. I'll just reiterate what the chairman said, and thank you for your comments that folks need to be careful of who they use. We would certainly encourage everybody to use local contractors whenever possible. The Chamber of Commerce is planning on advertising with all the available means that we have, advertising those contractors who are available to do work here. We have prepared a list. It will be in the Wednesday Sanford Herald, which goes out to everyone in our community. So we would just encourage everybody to use their common sense and due diligence and look at all the contractors that they plan to hire. And I have talked to all of our insurance agents who write property casualty insurance to reiterate to them that we were anxious to get this work done underway as soon as possible. Of course, every insurance company, we had thought about at the chamber to, having a meeting where we would review procedures, but every insurance company uses a different claim procedure, so that just seemed to be unworkable. So all of our members who are in the property and casualty insurance business have assured me that they are using every means possible to persuade their companies to get those claims agents here, and I was glad to hear that Horace Mann finally got some folks here, because that was one problem that we saw. So.
I did talk with Bob earlier today, and I should have brought this up earlier, but FEMA does have what they call a private sector division. Their only location in the state right now is in Raleigh. And they developed this division after Katrina, where so many of the major industries down there had been affected. So we've tried to hook up the private sector folks with Bob Hutes and EDC, but and we do not have a number for that section yet, but I'm assuming if you call emergency management or FEMA, they would be able to hook you up with those folks for, you know, mainly the Lowe's and the Tractor Supply and the Big Lots, you know, the bigger chain folks who can try to give those folks and find some assistance. We're not very specific of what they would be eligible for, but they said if anybody needed to talk, they would be happy to set that up.
Earlier this week, we had a EDC meeting, board meeting, and a couple of us were interested in seeing something done proactively on the part of the Economic Development Corporation to reach out to businesses. I think we had probably 50 businesses or more that were directly impacted or affected. Most of them small businesses, a couple of them larger ones, but most of them small. Companies like Burris Automotive and Cagle Furniture and some of these types. I mean, some of them were just raised by the storm. And I was concerned that you know, typically we spend a lot of time dangling carrots in front of big companies to come into Lee County, but in times of tragedy like this, we ought to take pause, I think, and maybe reach out to the business community and try to, because, you know, we're talking about a lot of jobs impacted there. Reach out and try to figure out what we can do to help them expedite the relief that may be available to them, either through SBA, FEMA, or otherwise. And didn't seem to find a lot of interest on the part of the EDC to want to do anything in that regard other than send a letter. But I'm just curious, have you thought about that from the chamber's perspective? It's something the chamber can do?
We have. We did meet with SBA folks, in Good. Fact, just a couple hours ago out at the McSwain Center. We have offered them free space available at our Small Business Expo next week. So we're going to have FEMA and SBA representatives available at the Small Business Expo. We've offered space at the chamber office for them to hold meetings as well. So we're going to try and have as many opportunities as we can. But as you all mentioned at the beginning of this meeting, it really is incumbent on our local folks to take advantage of this. You know, we can put it out there for them, but they've got to come in and take advantage of it. And we're going to try and get that word out as much as we can.
Good. And you're reaching out not only to chamber members, but other businesses as well.
The entire community.
Good. And I'd like to, you know, add one tickler to this too. I know Commissioner Shook may want to comment on this about the, I know somebody made a decision to waive the fee that Lowe's was otherwise would have been, had to pay for the counseling they were doing out at the Civic Center.
And they were a little surprised to get a bill for $700 for that, but John guaranteed me that.
Well, it'll be taken care of, but I'm sure they were just a little overzealous after I met with them and talked to them about their budget.
They being the Civic Center?
They being the community college.
And I would just like to say, I'm appealing to the sense of humanity on the part of businesses in this community and on the part of citizens and contractors in general, that, you know, in times of tragedy like this, what unites us and what brings us back together is that spirit of cooperation and the waiver of fees or the reduction of fees where it's unnecessary. Operate at cost or donate your time. I know Phil Stone, for example, was out in the St. Andrews area on Sunday cutting trees down for free that were risking certain houses, you know. And I think we ought to commend people that do that. And I think we ought to lift them up as examples and encourage people to do that out of a sense of humanity for helping out their fellow citizens and businesses. And you know, they may not be a member of a particular organization, or they may not be it may not be in a neighborhood that you live in, but we still as a community have a responsibility, God-given responsibility, to try to help our fellow men. And I encourage everyone to do that. Take on that spirit, and that's what will set Lee County apart from a lot of other places.
Right on,
Gary. Hey.
I've got a comment or a question for you. Why aren't we getting a report from the EDC regarding the businesses? I mean, we're getting them from all the other agencies that can provide some assistance. Why aren't we getting one?
Good question.
That's not
answer. All right. Well, I would make a motion that we empower the county manager to to have a direct conversation with the EDC director and figure out and try to figure out what we can do from the park. We fund the EDC to a very large extent, I think, and that we ought to suggest perhaps some things that they can do to reach out during this time of need.
John, are there vacant properties that some of these businesses going to move into while they're rebuilding?
An example.
And you know, I know the EDC and the chamber, we're trying to put that list of vacant properties together for the businesses to consider. But, I don't have a problem with asking, Bob and his folks to come to the meeting Monday. You know, we meet again a week from today. Have them come and give us an update. We meet at 3 next Monday, and we actually have, so far, a relatively short agenda. And I told our staff that we would not be having a long agenda on May 23rd, since I'd be presenting the budget. That will probably take up most of the time, that we're going to really want to be together on the 23rd. So they'll be waiting to June 6th for an item if they don't get it to us tomorrow. But we have a short agenda. I think it'd be a good thing to invite the EDC to come and at least give us a report on what some of these businesses are telling them about their damage and what they're going to do with their business going forward.
Well, just my motion then to say that I would move that the board ask the county manager to direct the EDC to join that Monday meeting and to at least develop some sort of an action plan of what they can do to reach out to the community, whether it's vacant buildings that can be made available or just general coordination or whatever.
Well, at the very least, a list of the businesses that were impacted by the storm. I like to know who they are.
There you go.
That was a motion?
Yep.
All those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, say nay.
Like to move that we adjourn.
Madam, I would ask before we
discuss after adjournment.
I had one other item I wanted to.
Well, there's discussion on the motion. He can turn the discussion.
Yeah, there you go.
Is there any?
Yeah.
I don't think you can on adjournment. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Mr. Hoyle?
Mr. Hayes is quick on his trigger finger. It can wait.
Okay. All those in favor to adjourn? Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed?
I tried to help. Yeah.
He's right on the Robert Newman order.